Welcome to InterParty Conflict, the podcast where we answer your questions so you can have the best tabletop gaming experience possible. My name is Gabe.
And my name is Jeff.
And we're going to answer your questions today. But first, Jeff, how are you doing?
Not too bad. I had to get up early today to go to the dentist on short notice.
Oh, no.
I chipped my tooth.
No, that's awful.
It was just one of my back teeth. It wasn't anything huge. And luckily, half of my family are dentists. So, like, I called up my cousin. I'm like, I chipped my tooth. And she's like, I just come in on Monday morning and, you know, figure it out.
Yeah.
And it was just like a little bit of just basically like shaved down a little bit of it. And it was fine.
Sure.
So that was like, you know. It was sort of interesting just because, like, I was real freaking out about it at first. But then, like, you know, after talking to her and then, like, looking at it, and I'm like, it's not that bad. Like, it's not like part of my tooth isn't missing. It's just, like, the edge of it kind of got a little sharp edge to it.
So gotcha, yeah.
Just had to shave it down so I'm not, like, cutting my tongue or risking, you know, chipping it some more. So
yeah.
Fun stuff.
Yeah. I don't know how it happened or really even when it happened, but a few years ago I noticed that one of my front two teeth – like on my two front top teeth, one of them, like the corner of it had a little tiny bit had chipped off. Like, I don't know. I didn't notice it. One day I was looking at my tooth in the mirror and I was like, oh, that wasn't like that a couple months ago.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, it was such a small thing. It's not going to like influence anything, but it's weird.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like I would have noticed that, but
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah. I only really noticed it just because it was so sharp and because I don't even eat hard candy that often, but somebody offered me a Tootsie Pop, but a Blow Pop.
Yeah.
Like with the gum in it.
Oh, I love Blow Pop.
Well, it was like an off-brand one.
From Charms.
Very good. It was an off-brand one, and like the flavor wasn't really good. And I'm like, this isn't really good. Maybe the gum tastes better. So I crunched into it a little bit sooner than I should have, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
And then the hard bits of the candy stick to your teeth sometimes. So yeah. I'm like, I'm feeling like a little sharp bit. And I'm like, oh, I just got a piece of, you know, stuck
to my
teeth.
Wasn't.
But it wasn't that. It was the fact that part of my tooth was missing.
Yeah.
And, and it was sharp. So like when I was like feeling on it, I'm like, oh my gosh. Oh, I just chipped my tooth.
So that wasn't a Charms Blow Pop.
No.
That was a Harms Blow Pop.
Gabe, I know this is your house, but get out.
All right. I'm out of here.
All right. Well, where's Lisa? We can take over the show.
She would talk about her dog.
Yeah.
I say her dog.
Her dog, right?
My brother's Kickstarter is doing very, very well.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yes. As of this recording, which will be about a week after, before you guys hear it, it's at three times its goal.
Right.
Like it met its goal within like 6 hours or something of the first day.
Right. Yeah. And it's been like less, like maybe just about a week that it's been up.
It's been, just like 1 week.
Yeah.
So it's crazy.
It's doing really well.
I'm sure he was not expecting this big of a response.
Mm-hmm.
I've even seen it referenced on other stuff. Like I was looking at I was on r/RPG today on Reddit and somebody had posted something about it was like a list of crowdfunded RPGs and like it was mentioned on there.
Cool.
So like this thing was written within the last week and they were talking about how it was looking promising and so on.
Nice.
So yeah, if you haven't checked it out yet, that website. Now just go to Kickstarter.com and just type in the Mountain Witch in the search bar.
Yeah.
Yeah. So definitely go check that out. Also, we have two new patrons today.
Ooh.
Within the last two or three weeks,
mm-hmm.
we've gotten three new patrons. We already talked about that. We already talked about one.
Yeah.
Last episode, I believe. And so we've got two more. Avin Schill is the first one. He's submitted some questions to us, as well as Joe. And I will say Joe is a coworker of mine.
Oh.
But hey, we appreciate the contribution nonetheless.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks for the support.
Yeah. And I do know. One of our other patrons, his name is Mike, is a coworker of mine, and I'm almost positive he does not listen to the podcast, but Joe does. So
sure.
Joe out there, thumbs up. You're awesome.
Woo.
Also our other patrons, you're all awesome
too.
Yeah. But yeah, just a shout out. Cause I will probably see Joe at some point in the next few, next few days. So yeah. And because of these new patrons, we've met our next goal.
Ooh.
So this next goal is that sometime soon, I need to pick a day, I need to figure out exactly what I need to do, but sometime within the next couple of months, I'm going to stream myself playing arcade games for, I don't know, a few hours or something. I'll figure out the exact details.
Right, yeah. Well, yeah, you'll want to put a little bit ahead of time just so people can schedule time to come and and see you.
Yeah, so like what I'm going to do is I'll have a camera or something looking at the screen. Mm. Maybe I'll have one looking at my hands so you can see the buttons. I don't know. I don't even know webcams work.
Yeah, we're trying not to get too fancy with it. Yeah. So there's no like complications and stuff.
Right. And then I don't know what I'll do, but I'll have some sort of like a set amount of time I'll play a game for. And then anybody who's watching can say like, oh, play this game. And then, you know, I'll play that game next. And then I'll play that game for a few minutes. I'll play the next person's and so on. Mm. And yeah, so you can make me play games that I'm really bad at. You can make me play games that are really obtuse and you don't know what the heck is going on, you know. So it'll be a lot of fun. I think we'll figure out some details within the next few days and then get them up on the Patreon.
Cool.
I'll cut this out if you don't want to, but would you be interested in taking part in any of that?
Sure.
Okay, cool. So we could, you know, not necessarily for the whole thing, but if you wanted to be there for a little while, we could play some Street Fighter or something. You could,
yeah.
Sorry, let me rephrase that. You could beat me in Street Fighter.
I don't think I'm any good at Street Fighter either. So I think we'd probably have a pretty even match.
Okay. So our patrons are awesome. All of you out there, you guys are great. Thank you all so much for your support. If anybody wants to become a patron, they can go to patreon.com/interpartyconflict. Mm-hmm. Even $1 a month will get you something cool. We've got $1, $5, $10, and all of them get you cool stuff and help you support the show.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you all so much. Also, also speaking of arcade stuff, I've been redoing something on my arcade cabinet. Ever since I built the thing, I was a little bit unhappy with some aspects of my control panel, like where all the buttons and stuff were.
Sure.
So originally, I was planning on just making a new one, like buying a new piece of wood, a thinner piece of wood, in fact, and then drilling all the holes for the buttons and then all that. And then it occurred to me, like, that is a lot of work.
Sure.
Why couldn't I just make alterations to the one that I have? Because what I wanted was basically what I have plus a couple things. I could very easily just add those things to the one I already have and save myself, like, hours and hours and hours of work.
Yeah.
So I've gotten most of it done within the last day or two. I still need to like get everything attached to it and everything, but it should be pretty cool. So once I have that done and it's all working again, I'll start figuring out some details for this Patreon thing.
Awesome.
Cool. You want to go ahead and get into the episode?
Yeah, sure.
Cool. So last week we talked about a childhood memory of yours where you were lured to your doom by a faulty decoder. Let's say it was a faulty decoder ring.
Okay.
It wasn't even your fault. It wasn't that you rolled a natural one. It was because something was wrong with the decoder ring. Well, you are okay. Your clothes are a little bit singed.
Oh.
Woof. But your mom got you a different box of cereal. This isn't Treasure O's. This is Gem Krispies. You got some Gem Krispies.
Oh, delicious.
And you notice this one also has a decoder ring. So I want you to roll a d20 and see if you can use that decoder ring properly this time.
All right. Let's see.
It was not a natural one this time.
No.
But it was a 5.
It wasn't very good.
So I'll just say this time, you are not able to figure out what the heck this thing is trying to tell you. You turn the little thing, you match up one of the notches with the notch you think is correct, and it's just giving you gibberish. Hmm. It's giving you like a different cipher or something that you then have to, you don't know what it is. You're a little kid, you don't know. So you, whatever, you just toss the thing away. You go back to eating your
Gem Krispies.
And you dream of the day that someday a cereal box will lead to you reaching the dragon's hoard.
I'm just eating it right out of the box.
You're crying into the box.
I'm crying into my empty bowl as I'm eating it out of the box.
Yes. Someday, maybe someday, Jeff, you will roll high enough to The thing is, I don't even know what I was going to have happen if you rolled high.
Doesn't matter. I'm never going to roll
high. You're never going to roll high.
It's just not going to happen.
The dice are cursed, Jeff.
Wait, where did we get these dice again?
Adventures in Aurelia. Oh. I won them. You should probably switch to some luckier dice, Jeff, or maybe do a ritual before. Anyway.
I'll bring my own dice next time.
There you go. So today's magic item was actually an RPG superstar item that I found. And this one, it caught my eye. And I was like, okay, I gotta bring this on the show. This item is called Defender's Door. So it has the word door in the title. That's interesting enough.
Yeah.
I will say, though, it's not just like a door.
Right.
But, I mean, sort of. We'll get to that.
It's sort of a door.
Yes. So this is a +2 dark wood tower shield made to resemble a sturdy door. So it does look like a door.
Okay.
But it's a tower shield. So it's a shield that literally looks like you're just carrying around a door.
Good.
So once per day on command, the wielder may stand Defender's Door upright on the ground or rest it against a wall as a standard action. When set, Defender's Door becomes a real door and can be opened or closed normally. The wielder must remain still to maintain the door, which becomes a shield again if the wielder moves away from it. So I guess you got to hold the door open for whoever's going to use it.
Sure.
Now, I don't think you can use it as an actual door. I'll get to what it does in a second. But like, if you were to put it up against a wall, I don't think it would let you pass through that wall.
Right, yeah.
Although that would be pretty darn cool. In 4th edition, that's how the portable hole worked.
Right.
It wasn't, because in a lot of editions, the portable hole is like, it's just a big extra dimensional space you can toss stuff into.
Right.
And then carry it with you. But in 4th edition, it was the holes from Roger Rabbit.
Right, yeah.
It was you slap it on a wall, now there's a hole in that wall.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, so creatures that pass through this doorway are transported as if using Dimension Door. If the door is set into the ground, so just like you just set it down, creatures passing through the door emerge at any open location within range the wielder can see. The location is set when the shield is planted, as is the same location for all creatures. So every creature goes to the same place.
Okay.
I should have read through this whole thing. If the door is set against a wall, creatures emerge on the other side of that surface as long as an open space exists within range.
Okay.
Range of Dimension Door is like 400 feet or something. So if the wielder closes the door or passes through it, it becomes a shield again. So I guess you could slap it up against a door, hold the door open for your party members, and then they would be able to go through, and then they would be on the other side of that wall.
You could also use it as like a bridge. If you put it in the ground and like there's like a ravine or something like that, they can basically step through the door and come out on the other side.
Yeah. For a moment, I thought you were going to say if the ravine is like 5 feet wide,
you can just set it down
because there's no other way they're going to get across that 5-foot ravine.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
It's like in Robin Hood Men in Tights, the bridge that.
Oh, right.
Little John is guarding. It's like a little tiny.
I'm on one little side. I'm exactly on the other side. I'm on the East Bank. I'm on the West Bank. Yeah.
Yes. So I thought this is a great item. How do you not love this item?
It brings up a couple things.
Yeah.
One has to do with the teleporting. The other one has to do with the using it as a shield.
Sure.
There's the, I think it's in Dark Souls 2. There are like guys who wield. They're basically guarding a hallway, and they're wielding interlocking tower shields that just look like doors.
Yeah.
And Steven, I don't know who was there at the time, but we came up with like they have a fighting style called door style.
Okay.
It's door styles where you hold a door in front of you and like just shove people around.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of cool. You can get both those shields and wield them at the same time. And when you do, you have a special attack where you like slam them. You basically like I don't know, slam them against each other like two
teeth.
Yeah, teeth.
Yeah, you kind of like interlock them together.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is the Lost Room.
Yes, the Lost Room. There's a great sci-fi miniseries.
Like one of the first scenes in that movie is like there's somebody pulls out like out of a briefcase or something like that, or it's just like this collapsible door.
Yes, this little miniature like 3 foot tall collapsible door.
Yeah, it's like what? I don't want to spoil too much of this.
I mean, it's in the first 5 minutes, sure. But I agree, it is a great moment because you don't know what this just this guy just walks into a store, pulls out a briefcase, starts putting together this collapsible door. Yeah. You're like, what is this guy doing?
What is going on?
But then he opens the door and all you see his face and you see like a beam of light coming through the doorway. And he like calls his boss and he's like, I have it. It's the real deal.
Right. Yeah. It's it's this moment that kind of like sets up like what the heck, like this sort of like what the heck is going on sort of feel. So, but yeah, I won't spoil that because that's, anybody who hasn't seen that, go watch it right now.
Yes.
Go watch it right now.
Set aside like 5 hours.
Yeah.
Start watching it. You won't want to stop.
Yeah.
And then it'll be, you'll be done. And it'll be awesome.
Yeah. And you'll be like, I want to play, of that.
You'll be like, I want to show this to everyone that I know. There was somebody who was making a mod for Elder Scrolls 4 Oblivion that was going to be Lost Room game.
Yeah, I remember you talking about that.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Anyway. But yeah, so this item is great. It does very much it does evoke a similar thing as that door in the Lost Room.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's really cool. I think it's interesting that the wielder can't go through the door.
Right, yeah, they have to basically stand there and hold the door.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Anyway. So yeah, it's an interesting item. And it's got the limitations. It's got the bonus that like lots of people can go through this door.
Yeah.
But the limitation that the wielder can't.
Yeah.
So
I think that's kind of cool.
It's really cool. It's a really nice ups and downs.
It's a door. You get to
It's a door,
around.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. I think that's this is a great item. I like this.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely one of my maybe my top 10 of all the episodes so far.
Sure.
I don't know. One of these days I'll put that put a top 10 list together or something. Anyway, so that'll do it for the Dragon Sword today. Once again, that was the Defender's Door from RPG Superstar from Paizo.com. So that'll do it for the Dragon Sword. If anybody wanted to submit magic items for the Dragon Sword or questions for us to discuss or stories for the funeral pyre, Jeff, how would they do so?
They could send us an email at interpartyconflict@gmail.com.
Yes. I already mentioned our Patreon, but once again, that's patreon.com/interpartyconflict. Mm-hmm. If you want to go there and toss us a couple bucks, it'll help make the show better and get you some cool stuff.
Yeah.
And I want to tell about our friends Crit Academy at critacademy.com. Justin, Ian, and Brandon, they produce new and reusable content for DMs and players alike every episode. Also, D&D Character Lab at dndcharacterlab.blogspot.com. Garen and Dan make characters and then debate whose character is better.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of fun. Also, we have a giveaway today.
Oh, yeah. All right. And our winner this week is Caleb C.
Woo!
Whoa, winner!
Gobble. Yes, congratulations, Caleb C. Let Goblinstone know whether you like or dislike the adventure. Hopefully, you'll like it. But yeah, Goblinstone is they're a great company. They make lots of adventures and stuff like that. So check them out at goblinstone.com. If anybody else wanted to enter this drawing, Jeff, how would they do so?
They could send us an email at interpartyconflict@gmail.com with the subject line, Chapel on the Cliffs.
Yes, it is that easy.
Yep.
We are always taking new new submissions, and we will have a new winner every episode. So yeah, just send us an email. You want to go ahead and get in some questions?
Sure.
Cool.
Yeah. Our first question comes from Jack through email, and we kind of touched on this a little bit last week. What's your opinion on using music and or soundboards during a game? Have you ever done so or experienced it during a session? So we kind of talked about this with discussing use of computers in a game. So having a computer on hand is nice for this because you can play, music at the touch of a button and, set the mood if you want to, or just sort of have background ambient music or something like that.
Yeah. I love the idea of it.
Mm-hmm.
I love the idea of having music and sound effects that like that relate to what's happening in the game. But generally speaking, I don't use them. For a reason I mentioned last week, like I don't really want to have a computer take up too much of my attention and so on.
Right.
But generally speaking, like trying to keep it relevant to what is happening is a lot of work.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm cool with when I'm running a game, I mentioned that I might like put up a soundtrack to something. I'll just like play some music in the background because I can just set it and then not worry about it. Or there was like an ambient sound thing that I mentioned that I put in the show notes for last week.
The one with the sliders and stuff?
Yeah. Like with that, you can set it and then for the most part, just forget about it. Maybe if you want to adjust it a little bit, you can.
Yeah.
But like with soundboards, I think to me, I'm sure people use them more easily than this. But like to me, it seems like I would have to spend a lot of time like keeping an eye on it and changing it to match what's happening and so on. Yeah.
Or it's another thing that you have to pay attention to. And it's a thing that is all timing too. So like, you have to devote too much of your brain power to like knowing exactly when to hit that, like that arrow thwump button or that sword clang button or, you know, or the Wilhelm scream or the, or my personal favorite, the Howie scream.
Which one's the Howie scream?
The Howie scream is the one that sounds like a TIE fighter.
Okay.
It's the one at the end of the Aurel Monsters intro from the old Nickelodeon cartoon show.
I never used to watch Aurel Monsters. Well, I didn't have cable until I was in high school.
Okay.
So if you're on top of the ball, like if you are comfortable with using this, I think it could be really, really cool. I'm sure it could enrich a game a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But personally, I just think it would... Like you were saying, I would have to devote too much of my brain power to keeping track of it that it would probably, for a while at least, it would detract from the game.
Yeah.
Now, I've heard there are a lot of actual play podcasts that use sound effects, and I think in those are great. However, it is important that if you are going to be using one of these in your podcast, that you add it in post.
Yeah.
As great as it would be to have the music be in the room so that the players can hear it, if... I'm all about editing when it comes to podcasts, whether it's an actual play or not. So if the music is in the room, it makes it so that you essentially can't edit out anything or else it will mess with the music.
Right. Yeah. You want to isolate each part of the audio as best as possible. So like having separate microphones, which is expensive, but it's easier to edit those things separately. So, you know, and then, like if you have music in the background, then that's just a whole extra mess of things they have to worry about in editing. So as long as you guys don't mind sitting in silence.
Sure. Sure.
You know, it is a lot easier to edit in post, and that way you can adjust the level accordingly. So there's not any part of the music that like is louder than the talking or that sort of thing. So,
and I mean, I would definitely be up for trying something like this as a, for a specific type of session. Like we talked about back in October, we talked about how to run like a horror session.
Okay.
Yeah. In a horror game, I would be much, much, much more willing to try out using a soundboard. I might do some practice beforehand or something, but to try out something like that, because the atmosphere is like really, really important.
Yeah, get one of those
type of a game.
One of those like CVS like ghost things, motion sensor things.
Yes. Oh my goodness, that's great. Sure. So with something like that, I think it's a lot more easy for me to want to use something like that. But generally speaking, I wouldn't. But that's not to discourage anybody who wants to do so. All the power to you if you're up for being on top of that.
Sure. Anyway. Our next question comes from Shadowhand Silverbones. And this was through
Steam.
Through Steam.
Yes, because I was on Steam and I was talking to him and he gave me some questions.
Yes.
So, you know,
How can I convince people to roll their dice faster?
Yeah. This again is sort of something that we covered last episode, but it's one facet of something that we talked about that we didn't necessarily cover.
Sure.
So there's a couple ways to take this question. I think I could have gotten an elaboration from him on exactly what he was talking about, but I decided to leave it vague so we could cover a little bit more ground.
Sure.
It could be that they are literally just not rolling their dice very fast.
Right. Yeah. Fumbling to pick which one and that sort of thing.
Yeah. And so with something like that, it could be that maybe they just haven't gotten the hang of which die is which.
Mm-hmm.
To me, you know, I can look at a huge pile of dice and just in an instant know which dice are which.
Yeah.
I know not everybody is like that.
Right. And like, cause they used to, they don't sell the kits like this anymore, but they had like the different colored ones.
Mm-hmm.
the really cheap ones that TSR used to make, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, like, there are different colors, but now most sets that you get are all, they're all the same, like, not like, you know, some of them have, like, different patterns and stuff on them, but they're the same, like, color scheme.
Yeah.
So, you know, it can be, it'd be for newer players and people who aren't used to, who just haven't seen those kind of things before. Like, some people are just used to six-sided dice with the dots on them. So, sure, like, it takes them a second to be like, oh, right, this one.
And, I mean, heck, there are times where I grab a D12 instead of a D20 by mistake. It happens.
Yeah.
Now, if you are the person that is having difficulty with something like this, I could give a recommendation. I would say try and take the dice that you use for different things and put them in different physical locations in front of you.
Yeah.
Maybe have your D20 on your right side, right where your hand would go. Mm-hmm. So that means every time you need to roll a die, the first thing you grab is just right there by your hand. It's the D20, so you roll it.
Yeah.
And then maybe if you have a weapon that you use a lot, the damage die for that weapon, have that be directly in front of you or something. Right. And then if you have someone, you know, tertiary thing, have that be on your left side or something like that. Or
if you got your character sheet in front of you, you can even put the die next to, like, the spot on the sheet where your, like, your weapon attack is.
Yeah,
so therefore, when you go to reach for it, you can see, oh, plus six, boom.
Sure.
You know.
And then that brings me to the next thing that might cause somebody to not roll their dice very fast. It might not be that they're not physically rolling the dice very fast, but it could also be that they roll the dice, but then they do the whole, what's my modifier? No, is it? No, it's not that one. here. Is it? No, that's not it. What do I add? My proficiency plus my, you know, everybody, you know, we've all been in a group like that. Maybe some of you listeners have been that person. Don't worry. You know, everybody has been in this place at some point.
Mm-hmm.
So similarly to, you could physically place your dice somewhere that gives you a signification of what you're trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
Like you were saying, Jeff, put your D20 directly by where your weapon attack bonus is.
Right.
That way, every time you go to grab it, you know it is right here under where I am looking.
Right.
That's the number that I roll.
Mm-hmm.
It's really just going to come down to whether you are conscious about getting everything ready, like preparing yourself for your turn.
Yeah.
If you are aware that you're the person that takes forever to roll and takes forever to add everything up, if you're aware of that, then you can just, like, I'm going to point my finger at it. I'm going to hold my finger right next to the thing. That's what I need to look at.
Mm.
As long as you are aware of it, you can do lots of things to speed up the process.
Mm. In my mind, I came up with something a little bit expensive and elaborate, and somebody who's going to spend this much time and money and effort probably knows how to roll the dice fast anyway.
Sure.
But, like, doing, like the cups, having like, there's the dice cups where you can, you know, roll your dice in there. That was the thing we talked about before.
Sure.
Where, like, so that it doesn't go off the table. You have it in a cup, and then you turn the cup over and then, you know, take the cup off the table and reveal the dice.
Yeah.
Have that, but with labels on them. And so, like, that's true. A set of dice for every different thing that you can do. Now, that can get kind of crazy depending on your character. But if it's like, if I have like two things, to, like two types of attacks to do, I have like a D20 in there and then whatever the damage dice is in there. And then at the top of the cup, I have like a label I can change or something that says like battle axe or something. And then you just shake it and go.
Yeah, no, I think that's a really cool idea.
Yeah. I mean, like, but again, like if somebody's going to take the time and money and, you know, effort to set that all up, they're probably not the new player that doesn't, you know where to look on their character sheet.
Sure.
I don't know. Maybe that's something if you have that sort of thing on hand at the game, at the session, you can give that to newer players so that they can speed it up. So, like, you know, give them the tools that they need to maybe speed up the process a bit.
Yeah, because that's what the question is. The question isn't, how can I roll my dice faster?
Sure.
The question is, how can I convince people to roll their dice faster, or how can I get people to roll the dice faster? So if it is not you and you're finding yourself just like you're pulling your hair out, just like wanting to be like, just roll the freaking dice, dude.
Yeah.
We've all been there. Don't worry. however, I've mentioned before that it's a little, what's the word I'm looking for? Uncouth or gauche or I don't know.
Yeah.
It's a little looked down upon to tell other players how they should be playing the game.
Sure. Yeah.
That doesn't mean that you can't encourage someone. That doesn't mean there's no way that you can help someone. But But if you are the one soliciting the help to them, it can be taken the wrong way.
Yeah.
So, you know, honestly, to an extent, I would say that this might just be something that you need to just deal with it. Like,
yeah,
get used to it. It might suck, but like, I wouldn't ever want to make someone feel. I don't think this is how Shadowhand Silverbones meant the question.
Right.
But I would never want to make someone feel unwelcome at the game because of something that they might be self-conscious about. They might be self-conscious about the fact that they have difficulty recognizing the dice or adding the numbers together quickly or whatever the problem might be. Mm. So I don't know. I would probably never bring it up unless it was like becoming a real problem.
Right. And I mean, like if the session, like, because sessions can go really long, and this is definitely one of the things that can cause that. And mm-hmm. like not being prepared for your turn, and then one of those things of not being prepared is not knowing what bonuses you're going to be adding.
Yeah.
Like that's a big part of not being prepared for your turn. So
sure.
You
could, kind of like what I was saying, you could just sort of recommend to them, hey, I keep my D20 right here on top of my modifier. Yeah. You know, you could say like, I do this. This is what I do in order to make my turn go by a little smoother. You could try that and see if that helps.
Yeah. Good luck suggesting that sort of thing to my fiance.
Okay.
It's like, she likes playing games, but she likes playing them her way.
Sure.
And if you're like, hey, did you know that you could do this and it'll make it easier? She goes, I don't care. No. It's like, I know, but I'm going to do it this way. And I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
But yeah, I feel like if I told her like, hey, I keep my dice over here, she'd be like, okay.
Yeah.
Like, that's what you do.
You know, it's kind of funny. The first time I ever met Shadowhand Silverbones,
uh-huh.
Because we went to high school together.
Yeah.
And we were both in theater. We had both been cast in My Fair Lady. I had a fairly large part, which I was very lucky to get. And he was in the chorus. And there was this one point where he was supposed to be, he like has a line, but then like he's supposed to act like he's talking to some of the other people on stage. And when he was doing it, I noticed he did this goofy little thing where he was just like flapping his mouth up and down. And I thought that looks really funny. So I went over to him afterwards and I was like, hey, you know, if you just say watermelon, 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 just say the word watermelon over and over again, it looks like you're really talking. You're not just like flapping. And he was like, oh yeah, I know. And I was like, oh,
but that's
okay.
Yeah, and he always liked to ham it up in some way, so
yeah,
that was just his way of doing it.
Yep. So yeah, that's kind of how I picture something like that would go. So how to convince someone to roll their dice faster? You could give them suggestions like, hey, I do this, you know, but try to be as unaccusatory as possible, and don't be surprised if that's just a mental block they've got.
Sure.
And it's just a problem you got to deal with.
Yeah.
It sucks. Like, I've played with people that their turn always takes so long because it's like, which die do I use? okay, I'll use this one. What do I want to do? I want to attack. Okay, well, where's my modifier? Oh, I'm supposed to roll? Okay. And they roll the die.
Or you
can... What do I add? Oh, gosh. Okay, I'll add this one. Ooh, what do those two numbers add up to? And it's like, it's the same thing you did last round. Just do the same sequence of events you did last round, and you'll be fine.
So anyway, you could implement a timer.
And you could.
And I feel like...
You could.
I might have talked about this before. Was like there's a timer, there's a turn timer, and then if you run out of time, like you have a set thing that your character does.
Sure, sure.
Like if you're a fighter, you just attack.
Just attack whatever enemy is closest.
Yeah.
The last one you attacked, if possible.
Yeah. So like, and then like, so you just have a thing that if you can't decide on anything else that you want to do instead,
mm-hmm.
that's what you're gonna do.
Sure.
And if you run out of time, that's what happens. Like, you know, the battle is like a round is 6 seconds.
Yeah.
You know, so like, you know, a character, I know the player and character are separate things, but the character is going to have less than 6 seconds worth of thought.
Sure.
To figure out what they have to act on instinct. So like, you know, you should try to do the same, but I kind of understand though that you like, I am this way where I try to like try to find the best action to take.
Yeah.
Cause like some battles, some like encounters and stuff are just really hard, and you're gonna, you don't want your character to die or anything like that. So you want to make sure you don't make any mistakes.
So this is a bit of a tangent, but I think it kind of illustrates what you're talking about. So last night, my wife and I, we went on a date. Oh. I haven't gone on a date in a long time, but nice. I was, I just figured, hey, we have the day off. Let's go do something fun.
Cool.
So we went to Motor City Casino.
Oh,
we haven't been to a casino in a long time. Many, many episodes ago, you and I talked about casinos, and I talked about my my method of approaching a casino.
Sure.
I think I actually cut it out of the episode, but it is an outtake you can get if you pledge at least $1 on our at patreon.com/InterPartyConflict.
That is not a gamble. That is a donation.
Correct. Correct. Well, anyway, so we went to this casino, and we like to play. We don't spend a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
I think I lost about $20. My wife gained like 50 cents. That was our night at the casino.
Nice.
And what we do is we go to like the like video poker machines, because you can you bet a very small amount, you know, like one play is like a minimum of like 25 cents or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can get a good amount of time out of $20. We were there for like an hour and I spent $20.
Uh-huh.
But I remember I was sitting, there was a little bank of machines. I was sitting at one of them, and you know, it's like draw five poker. So you hit deal, it gives you five cards. You choose which of those five cards you're going to keep. And then you deal a second time. And then if you get anything, you win some money. If you don't get anything, then you start a new hand.
Right.
And I'm like, each time it would come up and I would see like, okay, I've got like, I don't know, a 10, a six, a two, a king and a queen. And then I'd be like, ooh, I guess I'll save the king and the queen, because you win if you get two of jacks or better. You win at least your money back.
Yeah.
So I would like, okay, I'll debate and I'll save those two, hit the next one. Or maybe I'll get like two tens and a king. And it's like, ooh, do I want to save the two tens in the hopes of getting three of a kind? Or do I want to save the king in the hopes of getting another king? Or do I want to save all three but then have only two chances of getting one of those? And I'm like hemming and hawing over each and every one, and it's like a quarter. It's like no big deal. But then the guy next to me, he's just like, he hits a thing, bam, 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 hits a thing again, bam, 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 hits a thing again, bam, bam. And he's winning a lot of money. He knows what he's doing. He's winning more money than I am anyway.
Sure.
But just the fact that like he probably already has a better idea of what is going to be a better bet,
right,
and so
yeah.
on. Whereas I have to like sit there and I have to debate with myself over which thing is going to be the best,
yeah.
the best odds.
Because yeah, he basically probably just has the odds numbers memorized.
Sure.
Cause it's not like five card draw is not that complicated,
mm-hmm.
and it's just like, oh, it's like, okay, like this is going to have the highest odds. Okay, yeah. This is going to have the highest odds, or like this is what's going to be the highest odds. And it's like he does, you know, it's not more of just like, ooh, that's going to be a good. Like, if I get the full house, that'll be awesome. It's mm-hmm. more just like, no, this is what's most likely to get me something.
Sure.
Yeah.
So when playing D&D, like, this is sort of related. When playing D&D, this might be the rolling the dice faster or slower or whatever might have to do with just a lack of experience. Maybe the player doesn't know what the best option is at any given point, so they're debating their options. If they know what their options are, they're probably like, well, I could make this attack. Or maybe I don't want to make an attack. I want to cast this spell instead. Maybe I want to heal somebody. Maybe I want to, I don't know, do something that doesn't require a dice roll or something. Whereas a more experienced player or just a different player might not even consider those, because the more important thing is just to attack and just get this fight over with. So it could be that they are inexperienced. It could be that they're considering more options. You know, there's a lot of reasons why somebody might take a bit of time to take their turn, I guess. But if you do want to convince someone to roll their dice faster, try to just like offer up a suggestion. And if they don't take it, don't press it.
Right.
Don't be like, dude, I told you, set your D20 right there. You know, don't get like that. Don't get confrontational over something like that.
Yeah. I mean, like, or it could just be something that's like kind of brought up in general at the beginning of a session. It's like, hey, last session took a little bit longer than we meant to. Let's try to be on the ball of, you know, knowing what we're doing and stuff like that.
Sure.
So another question from Shadowhand Silverbones, again, was on Steam.
Mm-hmm.
As a player or DM, how to encourage a player to be more creative in their descriptions?
Yeah. So kind of similar to the last one, I would say that the you don't want to like tell them, hey, you should be more creative in your descriptions. Or I think I changed the wording on this question a little bit, but I think the original question was like, how do I say something? How do I deal when the player keeps doing the same description over and over again for each use of their ability? And you don't necessarily want to tell them, hey, you're doing this wrong. You should try it different.
You're playing the game wrong.
Exactly. With this one, I think the best answer is lead by example. Yeah. We've said that before with like how to get players to role play more, how to get your group to like follow, to stick to a consistent tone. Mm-hmm. Lead by example.
Yeah. And I feel like if you're going to be leading by example, like if you notice somebody isn't being as descriptive as they could be, and don't get too crazy complicated.
Sure.
Like keep it simple. Like give them a simple example that they can follow. So if you're doing like flavor text for a spell or something, just be like, it's, you know, like just figure out like what color is it? What does it sound like? You know, how big is it? What shape is it? You know, like maybe it has a smell. Like go for like the senses. Yeah. Something very easily. It's like, okay, so like even if it's just like, oh, I shoot a fireball, it's red and it's triangle in shape, it smells like bacon.
Ooh.
And it sounds like a firework. Like, even, I mean, that's better than just I cast fireball.
Sure. Man, I want that fireball.
the red triangle bacon firework.
Yeah. There was so a long time ago I played this game that a guy that I knew at the time made. It was called Corellia. It was this like really, really big, very rules based RPG. But in that, when like anybody can cast spells, and whenever you give your character an ability that lets them cast spells, you're supposed to come up with a visual descriptor, like a visual signifier that your character's casting a spell, an audible signifier that your character's casting a spell, and then what the effect smells like and potentially tastes like.
Okay.
Like, not that everybody is going to be like tasting everything that you cast, but like,
taste my spell.
If you were to do a magical effect that they were close enough to smell, or that was in a position for them to taste it or something.
Sure.
You were supposed to have all of that decided ahead of time so that in case it came up, you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
So I think I said like with mine, every time my character casts spells, like he creates these like spinning rings of blue energy. It sounds like bells. And if they taste it, tastes like cold water or something. I don't know.
Makes it like if... Wild magic exists in 5th edition, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Is it a mage thing or is it a sorcerer?
Sorcerer.
Okay.
It's one of the two sorcerer bloodlines in the player's handbook.
Yeah. I think it would be good with like a nice little like a generator, like an online generator or something like that. So if you cast a spell, like you can click the name of the spell and it gives you like a random description, because it's wild magic. It's just sort of like,
really cool, actually. You cast
magic missile, but this magic missile is yellow, jagged, and smells of rice or something. I don't know.
Jeff, this is a really good idea. You should make this happen.
Okay. I mean, like, I could probably get Dave to write up a. He's really good at Excel.
Yeah, so I
like,
mean that'd be pretty cool. Yeah. I would be down for that. Yeah. So like, really, just kind of, if you see that another player is using very similar descriptions every time or not using descriptions, the best thing you can do is just go whole hog with your own descriptions.
Sure.
They will probably see like, oh man, that was actually a really cool effect that he did. I wonder if I can do that. You know, if I start, and then they might start doing like a little bit here, a little bit there. Mm. And then over time they will hopefully start to follow your lead and do more of this, do more of what?
Yeah.
More variety and such.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I think that'll do it for all of our regular questions for today.
Uh-huh.
However, we, as we started last week, we're going to be doing our social media discussion question.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I might need to rethink how we're doing this a little bit because of how the timeline lines up with when we record these and then when I put up the questions. But so for anybody who is not familiar with this, maybe you didn't listen to last week's episode, what we're going to be doing is every week, I've already, for the last year and a half, I've been putting up a discussion question on social media every week for our listeners. On Facebook, in the Facebook, on Facebook page, I've been putting it up. Mm-hmm. On our subreddit, I've been putting it up. And on Twitter, I've been doing that too. So what we're going to be doing is every week, we are going to be talking about the question that I'm going to be putting up. So like by the time this episode goes up, the question will hopefully have been up for a few days. Now, I kind of goofed this week a little bit. I didn't actually put the question up until the night before we recorded this. So at the moment, there is only one response, but I will try to be on that a little bit more in the future.
Sure.
So the question that we did last week was, have you ever role played a dinner party? How did it go? We briefly mentioned a little bit with like our answers last week. I know that there was a session that I ran in the Age of Worms campaign. Age of Worms ding. And in that, the players were invited to like this big lavish dinner party or something. Mm-hmm. The players got dressed up and it was a lot of fun.
But a fancy dinner party.
Yeah. So we've never really, aside from that, we haven't really done too much in that way.
No.
I guess I did. I ran a game at the library where the players were invited to like a harvest dinner, and then a bunch of goblins attacked and their shaman animated the giant roast turkey and the players fought the giant roast turkey. So I guess that's kind of the same thing.
Sure.
A little bit.
Sure.
I don't know. Anyway, the only response we have from a listener at the moment is from Prozano, or at Prozano on Twitter. And Prozano said, yes, it went okay. A PC was introduced and did a horrible job. She tried to do something cool, but I accidentally shut her down halfway through.
Oh, no.
So I'm guessing the player said, I'm the entertainment. And then the DM said, no, you're not. And the player said, oh.
Oh.
Which is kind of a shame, you know, right, if a player is trying to involve themselves in the dinner party. I think that would have been
didn't mean to actually shut her down. It was right, more just like, no, I have something else planned. Wait, yeah. Shoot. Right.
That's where the improv exercise yes and comes from. You don't ever want to tell someone, if they come up with something in an improv, you don't ever want to say no.
Yeah.
Even if what you have is better in your mind, you don't want to ruin their momentum by saying like, no, that doesn't happen.
Right.
This other thing happens. Anyway, so that was the only response we've gotten on that one so far. So again, I apologize that I didn't get that up until pretty much the last minute, but I will try to be better on that next week. But speaking of next week, the question that we have for next week is, apart from medieval fantasy, what is your favorite genre for an RPG?
I want to say sci-fi.
Okay. Sci-fi is actually actually our funeral pyre is a bit sci-fi today. Ooh. So that's what made me think of this.
Yeah. I like fantasy sci-fi, like more Star Wars, less Star Trek.
Sure.
You know, I'm not saying I don't like Star Trek.
I'm going to isolate that audio of you saying I don't like Star Trek.
I'm not saying I don't like Star Trek. I spaced it out for you there. Yes. So yeah, like more like a fantasy sci-fi setting. So not too technical, but I don't know. But I also like westerns.
Sure, westerns are pretty cool.
That's sort of a neat thing. Like watery, like pirates maybe.
Okay.
I mean, not necessarily pirates, but more like nautical sort of stuff.
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm actually not a fan of sci-fi generally speaking.
Sure.
It's not bad. It's just like whenever there's a it's like, we've got a new kind of, we've got our own aliens. Our aliens are different from your aliens. And like,
sure.
You got to learn all these new units of measurement. You got to learn all these new technologies and so on. I understand the same thing could be applied to fantasy.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's I do apply it to fantasy.
Your magic isn't the same as our magic.
Sure. Our elves are different than your elves, but. I'm just more naturally accepting of fantasy in that regard than I am sci-fi. So I wouldn't say sci-fi is my favorite genre. I would probably say something. I'm really starting to like modern setting, like modern RPG settings.
Okay.
Like ever since the Adventure Zone recently, a few months ago, they started their new storyline. It's called the Adventure Zone Amnesty. Is what's called, and it is like a modern Monster of the Week. I think the game is called Monster of the Week, actually, the game that they're playing, but it is some sort of like a modern country town, you know, like small town people out in the woods encountering monsters and stuff. Like, I really, really liked that. And that got me into looking at podcasts and such, like actual play podcasts that are explicitly in modern settings. Hmm. And I don't know, it's just, it really, really struck a chord with me. And I've started to really get an interest in that.
What about more like classical sci-fi, like a 50s sci-fi sort of thing?
I could get behind that.
Yeah.
I mean, it wouldn't be my first choice, but
sure.
But yeah, I would be more accepting. I'd be more interested in playing a 50s sci-fi game than like a Star Wars game.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Because it could be tied in more like a sci-fi horror kind of game.
Sure.
Like,
sure.
Like the really old like black and white like sci-fi horror thriller movies and stuff like that. Something mm-hmm. based on that would be kind of neat. Like a anywhere from like Godzilla to like the Creature of the Black Lagoon sort of thing.
Sure,
you know?
Yeah.
Because that's sci-fi sort of fantasy horror thing.
Yeah, that'd be kind of interesting to play an RPG in like a Godzilla story or a, you know, yeah. like an old Universal horror
play it like
setting.
A D&D, it'd be like a D&D campaign, but it's Cabin in the Woods or something.
Oh my goodness, Jeff, I want that so bad.
I know you do. That's a question for everybody.
So go it's hopefully by this point it's been up for a couple days
at least,
so we will all of your responses we will read on the next episode.
Yeah
And if anybody has a suggestion on a better way to do this timeline wise
well,
I think
it's because we'd like the way that we delay things makes it a little bit.
Yeah, I know, it's our recording schedule, it makes everything
wonky.
Anyway, so yeah, go check that out. Reply on Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit, and let us know what you think. Yep. So I think that'll do it for questions for today. But before we close out, I think we should let's sit back. Let's take a deep breath. And let's toss another log onto the funeral pyre. And today's funeral pyre story was submitted by, I think it is Felicide Fang Fan on Reddit.
Felicide Fang Fan.
I don't know.
Oh, and Felicide Fang Fan. That's got to be, that's very vampire, like Felicide, like genocide, but fel as in like demon.
I don't know. Felicide is like killing a family member or something. Anyway. So they said, while sneaking through the maintenance tunnels of a space station that was being taken over by aliens, my engineer/comptech got backstabbed by one of the xenomorphs and died.
Oh no.
This caused him to drop his jury-rigged, highly unstable energy cannon, which proceeded to detonate, blowing the rest of the party into space.
Oh.
Fortunately, they were tough mofos with heavy cybernautic augmentation and were able to get back to the station with the help of one player who'd managed to keep himself grounded.
Nice.
So, yeah.
Did the...
Sucks to be your character, but I guess good job everybody else.
Hey, maybe it like sucked the alien out into space. That's...
Oh, well, I mean, maybe it blew the alien up. Yeah. I guess it didn't say.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's what in the movie... Isn't that how they did it in the movie Aliens?
Well, I haven't seen Aliens, but I've seen Alien, and in Alien, Ripley sucks the alien out into space. Spoilers for like a 30-year-old movie. So let's raise a glass in memory of the engineer/comptech who should have watched his back.
Clink.
So that'll do it for today. To submit questions for us to discuss, items for the Dragon's Hoard, or stories for the funeral pyre, please email us at interpartyconflict@gmail.com. For show notes, a running list of questions asked, and important links, go to interpartyconflict.com. Find us on Facebook, facebook.com/interpartyconflict, or our subreddit at reddit.com/r/interpartyconflict, where I post weekly discussion questions for you. We're also on Twitter @InPartyConflict. Find us on iTunes, Google Play Music, Stitcher, YouTube, anywhere you download podcasts. Please rate, review, subscribe, or just tell a friend. We recently started a Patreon and hit a new Patreon goal, so check out the rewards at patreon.com/interpartyconflict. There's a few different tiers, so anything you can spare, even $1 a month, would go towards making the show better, and you'll get bonus content for it. I should have mentioned, our next goal, I think, is at 125, I think. Anyway, our next goal is going to be I'm going to release my Nerd Night recordings from the library.
Oh, nice.
I did a bunch of Nerd Night presentations at the library on various TV shows, video games, and such. Mm-hmm. I did like maybe five or six of them that I recorded, and then a couple that I didn't record. And so I'm going to be taking the audio from those, and I'm going to be mixing them and making them sound good, and then putting them up for anybody to listen to. So
nice.
Yeah, if you contribute to our Patreon, pretty soon you might be able to hear me talk about Star Trek The Next Generation or yeah. Dark Souls.
Yeah.
Or I'm blanking on anything else.
The Sega Dreamcast.
The Sega Dreamcast, exactly. Yeah. Yes. So yeah, go check out our Patreon whenever you can. Jeff, you want to tell us about FriendQuest?
FriendQuest is a YouTube page where we played video games.
Yes. And if you'd like to submit some of your childhood memories of going to the arcade, either write them to us in an email or record it to yourself and send it to me that way at arcademoriespodcast@gmail.com. And I'm going to try to get the first episode of that out at the beginning of July. Mm. I'm thinking, because I haven't gotten a ton of submissions in a while, I'm probably going to do just maybe a couple episodes. Maybe I'll do it'll be like quarterly or something. Sure. So it's not going to be every week, but I'm going to do one episode and then maybe like another episode in a few months.
Yeah.
If I get some more responses.
Yeah.
A few months after that and so on.
Yeah. After the first couple ones, you might get more responses because people like actually experience it and like, oh, okay.
Sure.
You know,
sure.
This is something I can be a part of.
Sure. Also, you can head over to bit.ly/interpartyconflict to take a short survey about our show. What you like, what you don't like, etc. And just for taking it, you'll get two free printable board games courtesy of Mary and Tom over at hollandspiel.com. And our music is made by Boxcat Games from Nameless the Hackers RPG. So, Jeff, until next time,
have a nice day.
There you go.
I don't like Star Trek.